Hi, and welcome to this blog on Managed Edge Cloud as a Service featuring CRPD. This is Juniper's Containerized Routing Protocol Daemon. I'm John Nischel, and I'm part of our Telco Cloud product marketing team. And I'm joined today by a couple of our senior product managers from our Telco Cloud Solutions team. We have Antoine Sabot, who's responsible for many things, but including Edge Cloud as a solution, including our partnership with StackPath. So welcome, Antoine. And we have Marcel Wiggett, who is a subject matter expert on networking and everything telco cloud. And he recently put together a demonstration on CRPD workloads being brought up in a StackPath environment. So thank you and welcome, Marcel. All right, so just a little bit of background for our viewers here. So Juniper has an entire telco cloud solution that we call Cloud First. And this is built on an ecosystem of products and solutions that we bring together. These are the underlay, the overlay, this is analytics, this is automation, this is management. And we work with customers to integrate these things together, either as a complete Juniper package or as a multi-vendor telco cloud environment. So they can deploy what we call a build and operate environment. So this is where the operator owns all of the infrastructure, but more importantly, they own the lifecycle management of that infrastructure itself. But more recently, there's been a lot of interest in managed telco cloud services. This is where an operator would bring in a partner who would deploy an edge cloud service. And again, most importantly, they would manage the lifecycle of the infrastructure itself, allowing the operators to run any type of virtualized or containerized workload they want. So, they could run digital services that are revenue generating. These are things like gaming and video services. Or they could run network function services. These would be things that are internal to their own infrastructure. Things like 4G or 5G cups, mobile cup services, could be BNG cups, or this could be things like CRPD, which is the topic of our vlog today. So we're gonna start first with Antoine. So before we jump into details about the demo, let's just talk a little bit about StackPath. Who are they and how do they fit into Juniper's overall telco cloud strategy?
Thanks, John. So first of all, telco cloud is nothing new to Juniper. We've been in that space for a couple of years. As you just said, we've been there from a routing standpoint, all the Juniper routing gears power most of the telco's infrastructures, the data center fabric, supporting those telco cloud software infrastructure, and obviously the networking aspects of telco cloud where Juniper has played a key role to empower telcos and service providers. So we've learned a lot over the last couple of years. And as you just said, there is one very critical lesson, which is dealing with the lifecycle management and operating a cloud infrastructure all the time is a very complex task. And we decided that we can simplify and we can partner with our service customers, our telco customers, to make it much simpler for them and to abstract away that huge complexity of the underlying infrastructure. In order to do that, we think the best way is to mix and match a couple of skills and cultures. Juniper is obviously very well known for our telco experience and expertise. We're extremely good at securing and building scalable infrastructure. And StackPath, which you mentioned, is a great partner to add operational knowledge to this, as well as some very specific vertical expertise in compute and orchestration. So both of us together, Juniper experience in telco environments, as well as StackPath expertise in orchestration, compute, and operations, we've decided to join forces and build a managed edge cloud solution, which will help to solve some of the key challenges we've seen in the last couple of years. And if I were to name those challenges, one is definitely about getting the right time to value between the inceptions of the project and when the project starts running. We've noticed that it took really, really a very long time. The total cost of ownership of a cloud platform is most of the time not really under control, and we can help keeping that under control. And there is another aspect finally as well, which is how we can monetize those clouds and specifically those scarce edge locations, which is obviously something service providers are looking at. So together with StackPath, we want to make it simple, more efficient, and more economically viable for service providers.
That's great, Antoine. Thanks. So I, you know, one of the elephants in the room is that you've got hyperscalers or public cloud providers who have been offering these types of solutions and brokering partnerships with some of the operators, mostly tier ones in the Americas. So how is the StackPath solution different from what these hyperscalers are offering?
Yes, first of all, I think we need to recognize that hyperscalers and large public cloud providers have done a very, very good job to build a massive ecosystem and to get massive adoption from developers who are building value on top of those clouds. So definitely, whatever telcos are doing at the edge, they must have insights to partner in some way with those hyperscalers. The next question is how to best do that. One way is to keep on adding in some way silos into the infrastructure. We've seen that in the telco cloud already. Sometimes some vertical solution have been chosen. You have one cloud for IT, another one for voice, another one for mobile, another one for business, and so on and so forth. You know, we've seen kind of very, very fragmented space on the telco cloud deployments, which obviously increases cost a lot. So will hyperscalers be one more cloud, and given how many hyperscalers are out there, will there be another four, five, six more clouds at the edge? That can be one way, but we're not really sure that that's sustainable over time. What we see right now is mostly experimentation. So obviously there are partnerships being made, but it's all about experimenting, understanding what customers will do with those edge, and partnering again with some hyperscalers makes sense. What we have in mind on our side is to provide a foundation, a neutral foundation to service providers. As I said before, removing the pain of operating and building that cloud by yourself, which is really hard to do, and onboard hyperscalers into the platform. And we have multiple ways of doing it. Obviously, everyone is talking about multi-cloud. How do I manage workloads across multiple clouds? So that can be one way of abstracting away all those cloud locations into one single extended infrastructure. And so that would be one way. The other way would be to use, together with the telcos, the StackPath infrastructure, which very well interconnects and ties back public cloud infrastructure into their footprint as well. So we have multiple ways of onboarding and embracing public cloud ecosystems, while in the meantime providing a cloud-neutral platform on top of which telcos can monetize and can onboard those big players.
Okay, that's great. So it's not an either or, StackPath or hyperscaler. It's really an and. We can do them both.
It has to be an and. Yes, you're perfectly right, John.
Okay, that's great. Thanks, Antoine. So Marcel, let's shift to you for a second here. So you recently created a demonstration where you were bringing up our containerized RPD, which is a routing protocol daemon, and you built this up on a StackPath environment. So and I know we've got lots of other blogs on CRPD, but just for the audience here, can you give us a little bit about what is CRPD and why is it interesting to an operator? What are the use cases that they can build with it?
Yeah, sure, John. Well, CRPD is pretty much the, as you mentioned, the routing protocol process that we took out of Junos, our operating system for our network elements, and containerized it in a nutshell. Now, it's not just the naked RPD process. It's also has a CLI interface, a NetConf API, and everything runs within a container standalone on top of any Linux operating system. Now, people who have some background on Junos might remember that Junos is FreeBSD based, and that was actually written well enough that it was really easy to take this FreeBSD code and run it in a container which are Linux based. And it's the exact same code. It's not a separate code base, it's the same thing. And there's no forwarding engine in a container. You basically leverage the kernel network namespace that Linux provides. And CRPD interacts through API, through the Netlink API with the kernel for that. Now, why would you do that? Now, first of all, it's blazingly fast. I mean, if you use it as a route reflector, which is one of the use cases that I'm actually showing in the demo, then it deploys within seconds. and it starts loading routes. And it's also has a big stomach. It can consume a lot of routes. We're talking up to 200 million routes that we can actually easily handle with CRPD. Programmability, you mentioned already, yes. I mean, it's the same thing you use to with Junos. You can use the JET API, you can use NetConf, or if you really have to, you can use the CLI. It's still there. From the use cases, basically three major use cases we see it's being used, and it's a released product, so it's available now. First and foremost, routing on the host in the data center. So no more static routes, please. Use some dynamic routing protocols. Then the same idea on white box devices where customers have Sonic, but that features that are provided by Sonic routing stack, Quagga and FRR might not be sufficient, and they can opt for CRPD, which is a rip and replace plugin that we can put in, and we are doing that also on our own Sonic offering. And finally, the BGP route reflector, which is the most obvious use case for a routing daemon.
Okay, that's great. That's very helpful. Thanks, Marcel. So let's talk about the demo that you posted itself.
Yes.
So, you know, if StackPath and Juniper are managing that infrastructure, you used a couple of different tools in order to manage the lifecycle of the workloads that are running on top of the stack itself. Can you talk about what the options are and kind of what you show in that demonstration itself?
Yeah, sure. I mean, first, the StackPath, as many other cloud providers, offer a direct API that you can use to program through a REST API interface. They also offer plugins for Ansible and Terraform. And for this demo, I picked Terraform mainly because it has the philosophy of have a definition of the configuration in a file. And then you basically execute that intent that you described in the file and deploy it in the cloud. And I really like that because you can keep track of your changes. And if you screw up, you can tear everything down and redeploy. And now, one thing that I really wanted to use in this demo is StackPath is not just offering regions with data centers in it. They actually offer you an interface even for Terraform, where you can say, you know what, I want to deploy in all the major regions and do this basically just by listing the names of the locations. And those instances are remaining in a private network, all interconnected. So you don't have to worry about like an enterprise multi-cloud kind of thingy. This is a functionality that StackPath provides right away. With Terraform, in the demo, I also show how you can deploy it just locally, but then the same Terraform templates can then be used to deploy it in one or more data centers.
So one of the things that you've shown, I've seen this a couple of times with different workloads that have been deployed on StackPath, is the use of the Anycast address for performance, low latency, ease of deployment. Can you talk about Anycast?
Yeah, sure. I mean, first, Anycast, you might have, many of you have used it before. If you ever used a DNS server like the 1111 or 8888, or those are good examples of Anycast address. It's not a single server serving them. It's basically an address that is announced from multiple sources, from multiple instantiation. And StackPath offers this as an option, you can say, with your workload to be deployed, that it will also use this give you basically any cast IP address. And depending on your location, when you connect to that any cast IP address, you automatically reach the locust instantiation of your service. So in the demo, you will see I have in each region one. And then if you happen to be in Europe, you connect to the Anycast IP, you will get to the CRPD instance that is close to your region. Now, if this dies for whatever reason, or you downscale and you remove that instance, you will basically route it to the next closest one. And that's really an awesome feature combined with the capabilities of combining multiple locations into one private network.
Well, so I think one of the things we want to do, and after this vlog, we will post the access to the demo that Marcel's created so that you can see it as opposed to hearing us talk about it.
Right.
But you'll see how easy it is to access and use the StackPath platform. And you'll see how easy it is to bring up containerized RPD and on that network. So I appreciate the time today, guys. Thanks, Marcel. Thanks, Antoine. It was super interesting, very helpful. And we'll see you guys next time with our next blog.